We're here today to release 6,500 mussels of 7 species. And what makes this significant is that we're going to release 3,500 of 2 federally endangered species, the oyster mussel and the Cumberlandian comb shell. And all these mussels were propagated and raised by the Virginia Game and Inland Fisheries Aquatic Wildlife Conservation Center and the facility at Virginia Tech. This is a cooperative effort, but we have many other partners: the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, the Nature Conservancy, and also a lot of other public and private partners and nonprofits.
Come on, do you have more mussels? We really need your help here. We really appreciate it.
The real significance of this is that this is the largest release of larger size mussels in the eastern United States. So it's quite an accomplishment that we've learned how to culture these mussels, that we have come up with the facilities to raise them to this level, and the fact that we're putting them back in significant numbers that we think can actually start to make a difference.
Good water quality and a good mussel population are synonymous. To have good water quality means you're going to have a good healthy mussel population, and the mussel population is going to help benefit that by cleaning the water itself. It's going to filter out particulates in the water like algae and bacteria and actually clean the water up. There's the studies that have been done that say, well, you have a good mussel bed, it actually produces a good healthy aquatic insect population, and that increases the fish population, and then everybody likes to go out there and go fishing for that smallmouth bass. So there's a connection all with all these animals.
Everybody likes the river. What do we use the river for?
Swimming and fishing.
That's right, swimming and fishing. Believe it or not, we use a lot of it for drinking. A lot of the water that you drink comes right from this river. So do we want to keep it clean?
Yeah.
All right. And what's an animal that keeps the river clean? It's a mussel. Mussels clean the water. Okay, well, we're going to start. And the biologist, they're going to help you, and they're going to put a flag right near where you put the mussels.
And as a biologist working for the Fish and Wildlife Service, I think what is really important here is that after the passage of the Endangered Species Act in the early 1970s, recovery plans were developed for these endangered species, including these many endangered freshwater mussels. And so what we're doing here today is we're implementing aspects of the Endangered Species Act. Not only is the act intended to prevent extinction, but it's also intended to, you know, recover species and ultimately get them off the endangered species list. So bring them from endangered, threatened, and then ultimately off the list. And so that's what we're doing here, is part of that process.
And so when you put it into the substrate, it's foot down. Typically you bury it so that only this end of the mussel is sticking out of the substrate.
This area is very significant for freshwater mussels. The United States itself historically had about 300 species. And most of those were concentrated in the rivers of the southeast. Now, many of those have declined throughout their range, either by water pollution or damming or other factors. The Clinch River right behind me is part of the Upper Tennessee, and it's one of the last free-flowing sections of river. So we do see good populations of mussels, good species numbers from Norris Reservoir to Tazewell County. There's roughly 45 species of mussels here. Unfortunately, 31 of those have some level of endangerment.
I do water quality assessments with DEQ. I look at the water quality data that we collect all over the region on surface waters, analyze that data, and determine the state of the waters or if the water's impaired or not.
How is Southwest Virginia doing overall?
Southwest Virginia continues to have impaired waters added to the dirty waters list each time we do an assessment. But part of the reason is because we are doing more monitoring.
I understand we're working. We got some partners that are helping us out now to clean up those waters.
We have some great partners. We have, as represented here today, we have Betty from VDOT. We have the Nature Conservancy.
We've really benefited from the collaborations we've had with the representatives from Alpha Natural Resources and Arch Mineral that have participated in the Clinch Pile Clean Rivers Initiative. What we'd like to see is for that to expand out and get more and more participation and involvement from some of the other coal companies that operate in these areas. That would also apply to the gas industry. Gas development is occurring in this region as well. They all share the same resource interests. They all share the same resources themselves. And if we can get more of that dialogue and more of that solution-oriented effort put to the task, I think we can really find some significant conservation gains that will really benefit us all at relatively modest cost for any of us. So that's one of the big goals of the Clinch Pile Clean Rivers Initiative, is to keep that dialogue open and going.
I hope they get all their energy out.
Do you have to go back and teach now?
We're going to go back and we're going to write what we saw today.
All right, kids.
That's the exact same thing I did.
Let's come on out. You're getting really wet. Let's come on.
Oh, I believe the kids are taking a swimming break.
Yeah, it's fun.